Okay, thank you. Thank you all for coming tonight. It's great to see such a good turnout, especially for a topic like sound, which never gets enough attention as far as I'm concerned. So thank you all for coming. To start off with, I would like to just briefly look at what sound can do for the user experience, why you might want to use sound in music, and what purpose or functions it can play. So these are my top five functions of sound. They're not all of the functions of sound that exist, but these are what I would consider the top five as they relate to the user experience. And the easiest way to show you how important sound is just to give you a quick video clip. You've probably all seen the movie Jaws. Great use of sound in that movie Jaws. I mean, everybody, well, when I was a kid, everybody knew that doo-doo-doo-doo. We used to, you know, make little fish at the dinner table, doo-doo-doo-doo. And that's really interesting the way that they use that in the film, because they sort of set up that expectation that, okay, doo-doo-doo-doo is a shark, and you know, okay, I hear the music, I know what's gonna happen. But then sometimes you hear the music, and the shark's not there, or sometimes the shark jumps out of nowhere and you get no musical warning. So they kind of play with that expectation. Let me just play a quick clip. This anthropomorphism is really important because when we feel like our product is alive or human, then we feel much more connected to it. And we feel we have a much stronger relationship to that. We're much more dedicated to that product. Marketers often use anthropomorphism when they're releasing a new technology, particularly something that's really tricky or difficult to learn, such as, you know, the old Macs always had a smiley, happy face on the screen. The reason for that is, of course, that if we feel that this is alive, if we feel that this is a creature, then we feel like we can kind of understand this object. And it sort of breaks down some of those barriers that, oh, this is maybe not so difficult to learn. It's kind of friendly and cute. So here's another example. My TiVo gets me. Of course, your TiVo doesn't get you. It's a machine. But by anthropomorphizing it, it sort of takes away that sort of intimidation we might feel with using a new technology like TiVo. And it uses these sort of cute interface sounds. Sounds that are giving feedback to actions that we're taking. So it's almost like the creature is alive. Okay, so that's number two. Let's take a look at number three. Who spend their whole life just making sure that everything sounds exactly right, that the sound of the door closing sounds like a good strong German door closing. You know, you don't want it to sound like a cheap car. They actually make sure every single sound on that car is designed carefully to give an impression of the whole brand. This is a quote from Peter Drescher, who's a sound designer for games, and I really liked it. If the device is a superhero, the audio UI is the superhero's theme song. We can extend this idea beyond just the UI. The audio is really the theme song for your product, whether that's, again, whether that's product sounds or actually some kind of jingle associated with your brand. It's all part of the theme song of your product. So here's a sonic brand that you're probably familiar with. These four tones were very carefully chosen. As the musicologist Phil Tang describes in this video analysis, which I cut down a lot, but it's on YouTube, feel free to look it up. The pattern of notes are tied to a very long history of European art music that represented rejoicing and rising up. So the idea subconsciously is that we then associate the product with that sense of rejoicing, rising up. Obvious example is cars or motorcycles. Harley Davidson even went to court to fight for their sound, saying that it's essentially trademarked that their sound should be the only motorcycle that sounds like a Harley Davidson. No other bike on the road can sound like a Harley Davidson, because that sound is a huge part of riding a Harley Davidson bike, because everybody on the street turns and looks at you, and it's a completely different sound than riding a sport bike like a GSXR here. Last example relating to audio brand is using Mac again. You can see how important and recognizable sonic brands are when they get reused in popular culture. So the joke in this scene, of course, relies on our ability to recognize this sound. Okay, let's move on to number four.
Pedestrian and cyclist safety is a growing concern due to the almost silent operation of electric vehicles. EC Tunes is the intelligent external sound solution for electric vehicles. By adding sound only when and where it's needed, EC Tunes increases pedestrian safety and at the same time minimizes unnecessary noise. Specially designed director speakers emit sound in the driving direction and nowhere else. For example, when the car is switched on, a sound is emitted around the car. When the car is in reverse, the sound is only in the back. And when the car is driving forward, the sound is only in the forward direction. The sound fades out at 30 kilometers per hour when wind and tire noise is sufficient. Intelligent sounds are designed to increase pedestrian and cyclist safety. The sound is speed and acceleration dependent to give feedback to the pedestrians and cyclists on the car's movement and state. Introducing Safe Sounds, the intelligent way.
So number four is information and feedback. And if you've never walked around with earplugs in, I recommend it to spend a couple of hours, get a really good pair of earplugs, and you'll realize how much information you're missing in your day if you just block out sound for a little while. In particular, information and feedback, we find that it's disappearing as we come to digital and, in the case of cars, electric cars. That a lot of the sounds that we used to have in older analog equipment that we relied on for feedback, they don't actually exist in the digital realm. So for instance, cameras, that winding mechanism when you press the button on an old analog camera, it just doesn't exist in a digital camera. It's just imported the old sounds, so you still have that information feedback. I mean, it still makes that click and a winding sound, even though that mechanism just isn't in your camera anymore. And the same thing goes with your touch screens. When you have a keyboard, you know, quite often you can set the volume on or off, but you most likely probably have the volume set to on. You have a kind of clicking sound when you hit those keys, so you get that feedback to know that you're touching those keys. Like, you may have heard the story about IBM in the 1970s tried to introduce a silent typewriter, and they spent years designing this silent typewriter, and they're so proud of it. We're gonna have this great silent typewriter, everybody's gonna love us because they don't have to listen to that clicking sound all day long. And it totally bombed because the typists didn't like it because they weren't getting the feedback that they needed anymore. So sound gives us all kinds of information about what's happening around us, and understanding how and what sound is communicating is particularly important now as we move to more digital and touch-based devices. Okay, number five on my list. This is a video summary of some research that I was involved with for the past few years at the University of Waterloo.
The sound of slot machines may contribute to their gambling appeal. When someone playing a slot machine wins, even if it's a percentage of what they have spent, the machine makes a certain noise that indicates the player has won something. Researchers from the University of Waterloo in Canada studied the physiological responses of 96 subjects while they played slot machines. The subject played two games on a slot machine simulator, one that provided music and visual feedback for real and partial wins, and a second that gave visual feedback only. After they played, the subjects of the study were asked which game they liked best and to estimate of how many times they thought they had won more than they had bet. Subjects who played the machine that had an auditory response had more of a physical reaction to their body and said that they enjoyed playing that game more. In both games, players overestimated the number of times they won. However, it was much higher in the noisy game at 24% than the visual-only game at 15%.
Okay, so what was really interesting about our study was we got some very basic expectation responses that we expected. We hooked people up to galvanic skin response, heart rate monitors, and we had them playing with sound on and sound off on the slot machine. And like we expected, they had a much greater response when the sound was on. But what we didn't expect was that actually, even when they lost, and they knew that they lost, and visually they got all of these cues saying you lost, if the sound said they won, they physiologically responded as if they won. So the sound was sort of overriding all of this other input. I mean, they could stand there and say, yeah, I know I lost, but physiologically, their body's going, we won, we won. And another really interesting thing that we discovered that was mentioned there was that sound led them to overestimate the number of times that they were winning. So after they had sort of 100 spins, they said, how many times did you win? When they were playing with sound, they way overestimated the amount of time that they were winning. It's almost like sound has this residue that sort of carried over the next few losses and they sort of forgot about those. It's like it sort of just lasted a little bit longer, that feeling when we had sound on. So of course this is all related to classical conditioning, that were taken Psych 101, which I'm sure many of you have. We've all heard about Pavlov's dog being trained, when he heard the bell, start salivating, and associating that with dinner. And if you have a dog, you've probably also witnessed this, my dog barks every time the doorbell rings. And it was really interesting that a few weeks ago I was sick with a cold and I didn't want to take the dog out. I called my dad, I said, can you take the dog for a walk? He took the dog for a walk and then he came back outside. He rang the doorbell and the dog started barking. Even though the dog was outside the house now, he was just so conditioned that when he heard that doorbell ring, someone's at the door. He'd start barking.
It's me.
And guess what? We react the same way. Maybe not to the doorbell, but this idea, we have a conditioned response that's often tied to the sounds that we hear and what we associate that sound with. This can be either a positive or a negative response, depending on what our experiences are. So this is Jim Reeks. He actually designed the startup sound for the Mac. And this is a great video interview with him. I've cut it down. Unfortunately, the language is a little bit inappropriate, but let's just, we're all adults here. So. And Jim talks about this idea of this sort of conditioned response and how, there's a problem with developing a startup sound because it means you're rebooting. So essentially that might be a negative response for the user because, they're going to start associating that sound with, my computer just crashed and now it's got a reboot. So he's talking about how he has to design with that idea in mind.
I was thinking about, you got to hear the sound every time it crashes. So every time you crash, you got to reboot, you got to hear the sound. So it could become really annoying fast. And it was to be associated with this horror thing. Oh my God, I lost all my data. Fucking Macintosh, that kind of a thing. So I didn't want to be associated with that. I had to think of a zen, calm, I kind of thought of it as a palate cleanser, to sort of be a refreshing sound. And I wanted to take advantage of the speaker, but I also knew that other people's speakers were shitty. So I had to design a sound that fit a lot of different machines, different configurations, different sound environments, different speaker sizes, different frequency, a lot of different things. Some had stereo, some had not stereo, a lot of different problems. So I was trying to think of a sound that I could design that would work in all these possible things. So it was actually a lot of work for 2.5 seconds or whatever it is.
Okay, to summarize then, my top 5 functions of sound when it comes to user experience: creating and enforcing emotions, anthropomorphizing the product, branding, information and feedback, and finally the sort of conditioning responses. So let's take a quick look at how sound works in order to create that emotional response or the conditioned response or to help us anthropomorphize objects. I'm going to ask for a little bit of audience participation at this point. And I'm going to play you a quick clip of a song. And I would like you just to close your eyes and imagine that this was the soundtrack to a film or a video game. Just imagine what's happening. Okay, just think about, okay, what's going on in this team? What kind of day, what time of day is it? Where are we? You know, what's the scenario? What's the action? Okay?
Montages with a bunch of men and leather jackets and some kind of machine, like going somewhere or like building this machine together or something like that. It seemed like a montage to me, like
okay.
It sounded like something racing. It also felt like trains or something going in a direction through a tunnel or something along.
Okay, great. One more.
The first part of it felt like it was you're running away from something, and the beat was like the heartbeat. But then towards the end, it sort of felt like you were at a carnival at night with music and all sorts of stuff going on.
Okay. Okay, great. I think there's a right answer here. You mentioned night. Anybody else have night versus day? Pretty much everybody. How about past, present, future?
Future.
Okay, so maybe we have something like this. There's some kind of monster there, you know, it's nighttime, it's dark, there's some kind of chase going on, it's futuristic, it's very urban. So I'm not a mind reader, so how did I know that this was all in your head? Well, firstly, there's some universals that, when it comes to sound, that we all sort of associate with. Certain types of sound we associate with certain types of scenarios. And these go back to sort of, you know, our primitive mind. So things in nature that are threatening tend to be really low bass sounds. So earthquakes, volcanoes, you know, thunder, really big mammals, you know, big threatening animals. These all have low bass. So whenever we hear a sort of low bass sound, we associate that with threat and nighttime. If you've taken Psych 101, you've probably seen this before. We also have these universal associations with sounds and shapes. So if I asked you which one of these is Booba and which one of these is Kiki, how many people say the one on the left is Kiki? Okay, so the whole room agrees that the one on the left is Booba. It works with other words as well. But how do we know? I mean, how is it that certain shapes are associated with certain types of sound? Here's another fun one. What frequency range is the taste of lemons? So is it low bass, sort of like 200 hertz? Is it mid-range, which would be like my voice, maybe 1500, 2000 hertz? Or is it really high range, or 15,000 hertz? How many people say low? Medium? High. So how do we know lemmas are high frequency sounds? I mean, they make no sound at all, right? But we have these universal associations with sound. And all of this goes back to this sort of universality that all humans share. And you could do that same experiment, you know, with people in Asia, and they would have the same response. There's also conventional sounds, which rely on a kind of conventional agreement based on our culture. For instance, way back in the 1950s, most computers were electronic, and the easiest way to make sound electronically was to create a sine wave. So if you go back and watch 1950s science fiction movies, any sort of sounds in the future use these sine wave sounds because that was high tech back then. Well, now a computer can make any kind of sound it wants, right? You can basically, the whole universe of sounds is available to you on your computer. But if you go and watch a science fiction movie today, what sounds do the computers make in the future? Sine waves. And in fact, sine waves still get used for lots of interface sounds because we still associate them with this sort of high-tech electronic feeling. So this is the start of Star Trek. You can hear the sort of lots of sine wave sounds as they're sort of showing the screen of the interface. Basically, in the last 10 years, scientists have discovered what they call mirror neurons in the brain. And these are neurons that if you go and experience something, like let's say I'm attacked by a bear, and my auditory neurons are firing because the bear is growling at me, and my visual cortex neurons are firing, and my affective system's neurons are firing. If later I go and I just see a picture of that bear, or I hear the sound of that bear, all of the same neurons in my brain will fire. And what's really interesting is this happens whether it's happening to you or happening to somebody else. So if I see you getting pricked by a needle, the neurons in my brain are firing as if I'm getting pricked by a needle. So this is why they call mirror neurons. They actually mirror sort of the experience of other people. Some people call them Gandhi neurons because this is really what's responsible for our empathy. So in our brain, sound, image, and action are all linked together. If we learned how to play a piece of music on a piano, and then we heard that piece of music later, our brain is still actually sitting there and playing it while we hear that. And let me try this with you, just to see if this works as well. So again, I'm going to ask you to close your eyes, and ask you to think about a phone number that you dial regularly, and imagine the sound that makes as you press the buttons. Okay, I saw a couple of fingers twitching. So, maybe you either did that physically, started thinking about where you're pressing the buttons, or you're just mentally pressing the buttons. But the idea is that image, action, and sound are all linked together in our brain. So when we have an experience, or when we watch an experience, if it's on television, or we watch it in real life, we get these associations that come up again whenever we experience something similar. And this is kind of at the heart of why we like to play air guitar. We've all watched our favorite bands, you know, play that guitar on screen. And when we hear that music, you know, we want to make that action. We feel that action physically. So this is really what's at the key of this point, is that whatever we hear, we also see it, and we also feel it. So these three things are tied together. Okay, I don't really have time to show you all of the techniques that can be used to design and test for auditory user experiences. And I can't teach you all about sound design in a few minutes, but I'm just going to show you a few tricks that we can use to design and test sound. Focal sketching is one technique that we can use. It's really easy, you don't require any tools, and you basically just make sounds that you imagine that object would be making, for instance. So think about haptics, think about visual feedback. If you want to study this, Legend of Zelda games are really great. They always give you some kind of alternative feedback. Great sound in the games, but if you turn the sound off, you either get that haptic response or you get some kind of visual response. Really great alternatives. And finally then, customization and personalization is huge in sound, particularly when it comes to cell phones or anything you're carrying around with you, because that's really about broadcasting who you are to other people. So it's part of your own sort of personal brand, that idea of customization. Of course, this goes back, and doorbells have been customizable for decades. I remember my great aunt had this great set of chimes we used to play with as a kid. And now you can get doorbells that will play MP3 players, so you have sort of this endless possibility. That doesn't mean everybody's going to customize their doorbells, but it's a nice option to have, and you can bet that if everybody's door chimes were customizable, then a lot more people would be customizing them. And then along with those lines, you want to think about that scope of customizability. You know, do you want to give them sort of endless open possibilities, or do you want to limit the scope in terms of, say, okay, you have five options for your interface sounds here? Because the problem is, when you give them a full scope of, you know, go ahead, put your own sounds in, is you lose all of those functions of sound that I talked about at the beginning. You lose that emotional connection, you lose that anthropomorphism potentially. If they're picking their own sounds, then you know they're getting rid of anything you sort of set up for them as far as those functions. Sorry. So I did a study with some grad students a couple of years ago looking at customization of sound and how it influenced the way people played video games. And what we found was when people swapped out the video game sound and put in their own music, completely changed their relationship to the game. So it changed the way they felt about the game. It also changed the way they played the game. So the pacing of the music changed the pacing that they had their player run and gun through the game, or it changed the level of immersion, their perceived level of immersion in the game. So it can considerably alter the relationship that you want that person to have with your product if you allow them to customize. And then finally then is just to give you a little clip of my startup. Music they feel best represents aggressive and combat, rather than just sort of randomly having music play in the background. So players can associate songs with particular scenes in the game, and then they can share those over a social network with other players, and they can rank and rate other people's ability to pick songs for the game based on the keywords. So this is kind of a little teaser video that shows this in action. Understanding those connotations, of the universal and cultural connotations we have associated with sound. There's many ways to design, test, and implement sound in various devices, and I would very much be interested in hearing about your own experiences of sound in various products and devices. You can contact me. I'm on Twitter at vmix with two X's, on the web at vmix.com or gamesound.com, and my email is collinsk@uwaterloo.ca. Thank you.
Great. Why don't we take about 5 minutes of questions for Karen, and then we'll move to the VCon presentation. Any questions for Karen?
So with the vMix, like interacting within your game, like do you lose sort of the contact sounds and like sort of like the violent sounds that are also happening in the game?
Nope, it's just the music that goes in the background.
Oh, okay.
With you know, touch surfaces and you know, basically having to digitally bring back the sound, do you think we're losing something as humans?
Do I think we're losing something as humans? That's a tricky question, you know. I like tangible things, but that's maybe because I'm getting older. You know, I like the smell of books. You know, I like that sort of physical object. But I also like touch screens as well, you know. I don't know if we're losing something, it's just changing. It's a different type of experience, maybe. Yeah.
Have you looked into what makes sound annoying, particularly in interfaces? Like, why is a particular sound annoying?
There is some research about which sounds people like and don't like, so more generally speaking, not specific to interfaces. I haven't looked at what sounds people like and don't like specifically, no. But if you're interested in sort of which sounds generally people find annoying, Trevor Cox, who works out at the University of Salford in the UK, did a bunch of studies. If you look up horrible sounds on the internet, he actually did a web-based study and came up with sort of the top 10 worst sounds. Of course, there's like somebody vomiting and a baby crying, like things you would never use in your interface anyway. But there is some sort of, you know, you can delve into that and look at why are certain types of sounds perceived as more annoying than others. Yeah.
Is the effect of you know, constant earplugs or, you know, earphones in our ears and making our own sound environment affecting the way we react to sound? I mean, it's rather recent, you know, maybe in the past 10 years that everybody's wearing headphones or earphones. But
yeah, you know, there's some studies about this as well, and it has more to do with our social interactions being cut off than actually what that's doing to us in terms of the feedback sound that we're getting, say from walking and so on. I'd be curious to know as far as how it affects our own sense of personal space that we have, that once you sort of take that sonic feedback away. They've done studies with little babies, and babies recognize which sounds belong to them and which sounds belong to other people, like within 6 months of their life. Like they know that this is my sound, you know, I'm making this sound, and this is part of me, part of my sort of my personal space. And what goes beyond that, I mean, that's like, that's something else. So I wonder what happens when you sort of block out all of those cues and you're saying, you know, this is me, but me also sort of expands out into this whole world out here as well. There haven't been any studies, as far as I'm aware, that relate to that aspect of wearing headphones all the time.
Question. Oh, yeah. For years in web design, especially, sound has been seen as like a very, very bad thing. Like, don't add music, don't add sound effects to websites. And it's not the case with apps. Like, we tend to really enjoy apps that have really good sound design. Do you have any insights on why that's the case?
You guys are hitting me with some hard questions today. I think a lot of times if we're just surfing the web, we already have our own sort of sounds playing. We have our own sort of, and with the web grew up sort of in the early days of being silent, so maybe we just sort of expected that it's going to be silent. I know, you know, when I go to a website and it's got sound on it, I find it really annoying because suddenly, you know, I have this blaring sound that's usually at a volume way higher than the music I have playing in my background. And usually that sound is completely disconnected from what the website is about. I have seen some great websites with some really nice interface sounds, you know, where you're touching buttons or something, it just gives a really nice soft, you know, little marimba or xylophone as you're hitting those buttons, and it works really well. I think there's just been so many bad examples that it kind of put people off sound on the web altogether, quite possibly.
So, because Remix actually analyze the playlist and say, you know, give me suggestions,
So the question was, does vMix do any kind of analysis of a person's playlist? That is actually our next step. So we're collecting data as far as what people pick when we give them cues and say, okay, what's aggressive music? You know, what songs are people picking for this? What are the common denominators? You know, we're throwing into neural nets, looking at, okay, these elements and songs are often picked for, you know, for aggressive cues. And then the next step will be, we can just sort of automatically scan your playlist and say, you know, we're gonna recommend you have these songs for those events, yeah, for sure. It's in the works.
Do you have any research on audio navigation and audio browsers, especially when you're driving?
There's loads of stuff that's being done as far as sonic navigation, sonic browsing. There's loads of stuff. If you want to give me your email after, I can send you a list of it. There's quite a lot that's being done.
Have you heard of Busy Sonics? Busy Sonic or Busy Sonics? They're actually out of University of Maryland, and they really actually impressed me with the. So it's an HRTF plus some secret sauce, and I've never really gotten consistently front and back with any consistency, and hardly ever up and down at all. So this is like headphone 3D audio techniques, and they're doing it pretty well. Moved it all the way around my head. Do you have some comments on how using sound within a three-dimensional environment could be used for like productive environments, like people actually doing work? They commented on a beta client had been asking them to make it possible for the terminal user to push the sound off to the side, sort of in second place to other work that they were doing simultaneously, in the sense that it didn't warrant visual priority at that time, but could be tucked off to the side and monitored in the oral room and then brought back. Have you done any studies with sort of expanding your cognitive workspace, the square footage thereof, by being able to push attention items off to the side? Because you can listen to things in a much larger space than what we can actually watch.
I haven't personally done any research like that. I know a lot's been done. The U.S. Naval Institute, you know, looking at, for instance, helicopter pilots, they have to have all kinds of information. And sound is really good to reduce your cognitive load when you're trying to take in an awful lot of information. You can sort of offload some of that information sonically, and your brain can sort of be tracking it while you're visually looking at other things. So certainly there's research out there. I haven't looked at it personally.
Okay, we're going to take about 2 minutes here. Karen, thank you very much. And while we are setting up, there is one great book. If you only want one book to get sort of the cognitive science of sound, it's called Your Brain on Music. You get it on Amazon. It's an amazing book, especially for those of you who are involved in UX. It's a great, great text. Okay, come
on, guys. Just text it. You want me to text it? Thank you.
talk. As I said at the beginning of the evening, I met these individuals at UPenn in the IPD program down there last year, and things have progressed extensively from when I saw them last. If you like what they have, they're going up on Kickstarter in the middle of the month. Go ahead.
Hey, Charles. So first off, I'm just like absolutely thrilled to be here. I want to thank Charles Mauro and Emily Fisher and everyone else who helped put on this event. I'm really excited. I also want to thank Karen Collins for teaching us so much just in a half an hour. I mean, we need a professional sound designer. That's a fact. We're all here because we love music and sound. How's everybody doing? Let's make some noise. My name is Ben. I'm here with my partners, and our company's called Beef Farm. John's getting set up. We make a little beef maker for action sports. We'll show you what we really mean by that in a second. We'll do some live demos, and we'll talk to you about kind of our process. And so we'll cover three topics today. And this is our first launch in a startup, so we're just going to kind of talk about our experiences in creating our first music and hardware product. And the three topics we're going to talk about are communicating experience and designing for extreme environments. And the third is software. We call it the invisible software. So as actually our first thing we're talking about is the challenges of communication. This is something we always we always have trouble communicating, but we're going to walk you through it. So John Hunchar, he's the guy who handles the software development and engineering on our team, and Kenneth Blue handles the product design and graphic design. So here's our three topics again: communicating experience, design for extremes, and invisible software. So of those three topics, we're going to carry through one big theme. And our theme today is lose user. So we don't mean lose touch with the user, lose connection to the user. What we really mean is lose the word user. That once you've dove into a project or are developing a product and experience, that substituting the word user for a more meaningful word, in our case, the writer, has been just one small thing that we've done that's made a big difference. The way we ask questions, the way that we analyze the feedback that we get from our riders, just using that word rider has been really helpful. And in your case, you may be designing an app for the next chef, software for the artist, the next product for the hero, or even the explorer. So dive right in. First topic is communicating experience. This has been one of our challenges we saw today. And I think the tough part is because communicating an experience, it's not really an object itself. It's tough to put your finger on it. It can be just this visceral moment that you share with other people, or it's more personal. So how do you communicate that? We're going to talk about the different ways we've just experimented with. And right off the get-go, one other quote we learned, this helps us a lot: perception shapes reception. This was from one of our professors at school. And we found this to be really true, that the way that we present the information has always affected the way that we receive any kind of feedback on. So we'll show you all the different ways that we present our little beat maker, and you can kind of think to yourself, how do I receive this, which one's more effective? Are these guys really communicating the best possible way? Before we even had a physical product, we just had a concept. So we started off by coming up with a verbal pitch. And here's what it was: electronic device. It senses motions and uses an algorithm to generate audio feedback. So technically that's true, that's what this does. But it kind of misses the beat. It doesn't really, it doesn't really say much at all. We still get, what is it? What are you guys making? And just taking one next step forward, we thought about it from the writer's perspective and using their language. And here's what we came up with there: is it's a portable device that remixes music in real time based on your tricks, turns, and spins. So it's just a little bit more concrete. Again, it's still kind of like communicating it verbally. What is it? What is this thing? And then, so our next step was, how do we describe the experience? You know, what does it feel like to really use this product? And here's our tagline, be the beat. And that kind of arose from becoming one with the beat, becoming one with music, connected to it, one-to-one. Be the beat. And so now what we're going to show you is the product live in action, and you can kind of compare yourself which one communicates the best to you. I'm going to hand off to John, who's going to talk through the different moves as we go through.
So when Ben gets ready, just a quick explanation of how you set up your beat fun. What you do is you get the device and a mount that sticks to the board, and you just drop it in, twist it, and lock it on. And then the device connects wirelessly with an app. And then all you do is put your headphones in, put your phone in your pocket, and when you're ready to ride, all you do is reach down and tap the button on the device.
Is this product for the rider? It's just really for the rider again. And we have to say, you know, it's definitely a different experience. One example is, you know, we wouldn't drive 6 hours north to go balance boarding, but we do that to go to Vermont, you know, have to drop a hat. So there's definitely a difference there. One more reminder, lose the user. You see this guy, he's got riding on the back of his mind all the time. So this product really started as being designed for snowboarding. But as we've tested it out, we've gotten a lot of different feedback. We've discovered there, you know, there's tons of different sports and other applications that could be used for it. For biking, surfing, skating, all these cool things that are really exciting. But what's been a challenge for us is, where do we set the boundaries? Where do we know where to design this product for first? And so we came up with a simple mantra, and we call it just ride first. If we have a tough decision, we're not sure where to design this product for, and we want to just have a quick answer. We think rider first. This is who really matters to us. And we encourage you, and you could do the same. If you want to design for the chef, it's for the chef first. But maybe instead it should be more for the mother first. Or you gotta design for the artist first. Or the unicyclist first. He needs some love, you know? And so we've shown you now live on the balance board, where we talked about the extreme environment. So just last week we went to Mount Snow, Vermont, and we finally got this product out in the snow to test it. We learned so much. And now I want to show you a video so you can see firsthand John Hunchard riding, snowboarding.
You gotta plug the sound up to the speaker.
Yeah. Mount Snow, it helped us to ask a lot of tough questions. You know, how do our users view technology? Do users like tiny buttons? What will users forget? But then right away when we were able to just take a step back and say, this is really about the rider, and rephrase the question from the rider's standpoint. How do riders view technology? Talk about that real quick in the software portion. Do riders like tiny buttons? You can kind of picture them with like the coldness and the big mittens. Not the right fit. And what will riders forget? You know, they're gonna forget a lot of things. They're gonna forget their mitts, they'll forget, you know, the headphones, socks, just about anything. You might forget, you know, your snow pants. Just on our last trip, we went to Vermont a couple weeks ago, drove 6 hours north, and I of course forgot snow pants. So going to this board shop, ended up being a really cool experience. There's a guy there who had this really gnarly beard. He was definitely like a core rider. He was so excited to be there early season. So we're picking up these snow pants, and he was just put them on the counter, and he's talking about it. He's like, "Oh, you guys got a really good pair of pants here." And I'm like, "Yeah, it's not good." And he's like, "Yeah, like 10K ratings." Like, "Yeah, it's awesome." He's like, "Nice little pair of pantalinos you got here." I'm like, "All right." And then we got in the car, and we're like, "Did he say pantalinos?" And yeah, he did. And that was awesome. And for that was a moment where we knew that this guy was more than just a user. You know, he was a rider through and through. And so how could we, you know, think of him as anything other than our pure rider? So that was awesome to us. Software in action sports, it has a really strange place. It's not really there at all yet. If you go on the mound and check out what people are doing, some people are starting to get on their phones a little bit, but really there's no software. There's some apps coming out, there's some data tracking devices, but it's pretty new. And so that kind of makes us ask a question, you know, why is that? Why aren't there software products out there? This is a quote we got before we even started even the concept for this project. And this is a snowboarder and a student who just, his way of talking about snowboarding was awesome. It was so pure. He said, "It's like I'm riding the rhythm of nature." And when you think of like a gnarly snowboarder, you don't really think of them as being these deep kind of zen people, but that's what we were discovering, and that was really cool. So when you think of a quote like this and a guy like this, you know, how do you design software for someone
you know, who's thinking of snowboarding this way? How do you put an algorithm and numbers to something like this? And so we just always kind of keep that in the back of our minds. How do we make a rider, you know, like Andrew, really happy? So we go back to how do users use software versus how do riders use software? You can see it just can't even be there. It has to be invisible. It's in your pocket. You can't really be interacting with software directly if you're in these intense, extreme environments. So that's what we know. This product has to be kind of a passive product, and it has to be protected really well, you know, for the rugged, under snow type experience. As we were driving back from our last trip, we were just reviewing like all the fun times we were having. We were surrounded by so many riders just having a blast. And it was tough to ignore that because, you know, you're just in there. We're working on this product, doing research for it, but really, I mean, there's just so many riders having fun. We couldn't ignore it. And like as we were driving back, we were thinking, that's what this product is all about. That's what we're all about. It's just making something that's fun for everyone who tries it. And it made us think of an analogy to Nintendo, that if when we come out with our first products, we want, you know, we may not be able to have the best graphics and the most buttons. You know, our buttons are turn, spin, and jump. And that might be okay if we can just set the ground at one level playing field so that people can experience the product and feel their own level of customization. Just have fun with it. So in our final balance board demo, we're going to show you some of the settings that we've developed so that all different types of riders can enjoy the product depending on their ability level.
Hopefully we didn't put too much customization to the sound in that during this presentation. Alright, so in the last round, you heard some of like the stock settings that we built into the product. What we want to show this time is, you know, how we can change it up for different types of riding and different types of riders. So we're going to start off with a song, an 8-bit song, chiptunes. It's called Chip Flips by Pixelator for all you Nintendo fans. So, like you saw the last one, I've got a bit more of a thank you.
drives fadery and extra snappy cars.
All right, so Ben likes to build it quick and fade the music out quick.
Just make me sweat. Chef, explorer, whatever, whoever you're designing for. At this stage where we're at is, you know, to kind of circle back, we focus on communicating the experience, designing for extremes, developing software even in an invisible environment. But what we have to start asking ourselves, at least at this point, is what are we really selling? And the way we've answered it so far has been more about, you know, what are we not selling? And in this case, you know, we're not selling a device, we're not selling software, we're not selling an app. You know, what we're trying to sell is really the ultimate music experience. And you might be working on something similar where you're selling just one moment or one action, some little thing that just makes an impact in someone's life. And that's awesome. That's just one amazing thing that an experience can do. So, this is, at the end, we just want to leave you with one final note. Back when I was a kid, I used to play piano recitals, and it was really, really terrible. And finally switched over to drums. But throughout both, I learned one lesson, and that was to never stop playing. That no matter what, when you miss a note, you miss a beat, that you keep playing through the music, never stop playing. And so I think that's true of music, but I also think that's true of everything you do, whether it's your business, product, experience that you're developing, that you never stop playing, you keep playing through. So that's your final message to keep playing.
Okay, questions for the Beat Farm folks?
Okay. That was an awesome demo, by the way. I was just curious about the music. Do you, for some of the effects, it seems like you have to have multiple tracks, multiple layers inside of it. So you have to have basically the music designed for the system in order to be able to play in the system?
Yeah, I guess the artists that we've been working with have been giving us the step files to their music. But that's something we're working on now, is a single track loop, so you can just play right off your iTunes music, which I think would make music more accessible, because right now we only have a couple of tracks.
Okay.
Are you guys considering doing like licensing work with other artists to maybe like insert like stems and bits of tracks into it so they can basically make a customized like farm version of an existing musical track?
Yeah, I think that's a great idea. What currently we've been reaching out to artists that are just kind of underground and getting their name out there, and to start reaching out to bigger artists and kind of license their professional tracks would be an awesome thing. So.
Played SSX.
Absolutely.
So was that sort of an inspiration behind this?
I actually talked to one of the designers last year about it. Okay. He like went to a career fair and just like hit him up and try and get some numbers. And EA Sports, and he got in touch with him. But it was cool because they remixed the music.
Yeah, I mean, it's essentially the same kind of thing where you have it's a snowboarding game for Xbox, PlayStation, and depending on what actions you take in the game, there's sort of real-time DSPs put on, so different phasing effects and so on, maybe a similar kind of drop of the beat when you land and so on. So you could actually do that kind of
thing on if you just have a single track, it just has sort of DSP effects in real time. There's a great presentation on the Game Developers Conference website from last year by Gordon Jury, who built that reverse stack for SSX, so check it out.
I have a question. Now, you guys, I used to snowboard as well. I haven't gone in a while, now I live in New York. But I grew up snowboarding on the East Coast. Now, snowboarding on the East Coast kind of sucks for early season when it's icy and whatnot. So what happens if you fall?
Wait, Justin Bieber.
I'm not attempting to demonstrate falling.
This point is kind of a grab bag, depending on how the board flips and holds and turns with your body. I don't know if we've identified like a specific falling motion data. I guess it's harder to commit to falling when you've got a test. I don't want to be a test.
I don't snowboard, but I ski, and I ski to music sometimes. And like skating to music, or you know, when you see in the Olympics, or skating to music, or skating to the rhythm, because it's sort of driving your motion. This sounds to be the other way around, and I wonder how that affects, you know, you're creating the sound, and I imagine it can be also a little bit disturbing because it's also slightly delayed, right? So, you know, you jump and then you hear the sound change, now maybe microseconds, but you're pretty sensitive to it. How does that change the whole mentality of skiing or skating or doing anything to music versus making the music?
Yeah, I mean, I think when we first actually rode with it, we definitely rode differently than we would normally to make the music sound a certain way. Like, I wanted that car to build that track. And the same with jumps. It was actually kind of encouraging to just go off more jumps to test it out. But I do think that's interesting with the time delay. I don't know if you've noticed anything with the delay, but...
Yeah, I mean, there definitely is, like, a small amount of delay. Personally riding with it on the mountain, I guess I view the music differently than if I were just listening to, you know, my regular playlist. Because I'm kind of thinking like, oh, what is this move going to do? So I'm like anticipating how my move will change the music as opposed to just kind of, yeah, I guess it does flip it. But I think just the way you think about it is, it is
are you thinking about adding a game layer to modify? Because I know with like Maple Fuel Band, you push to get to that next level, so are you going to try to think about that? Do more tricks to try to, you know, tech out your rides more?
Yeah, I guess at this point we've stayed focused on being in the moment and creating just the best music track we can, whether you get rewarded for that just through the music, not just kind of really. But I guess our inspiration on going back to the Nintendo, that it's just a simple form of feedback, and just but Nintendo is a really cool gaming system, so I don't know, it's definitely something to always be thinking about.
I don't know what you mentioned, somebody mentioned SSX over there. Have you guys looked to like research of Lumines?
What was that?
Puzzle game, Lumines. It is pretty much exactly what you guys are doing in a puzzle version. Like an actual, not like DSP, like sound manipulation, but actually like specific layers and elements of tracks built in that's completely dependent on actual user actions and accomplishments in the game. I don't know if you guys looked into it. It's originally a Japanese game, but it might be worth researching.
That's not possible.
Yeah, check that out.
I was curious, have you thought at all about, so it's kind of like you're remixing your own version of the song every time you ride, right? Have you thought about the app kind of recording it so you can listen to that, like, you can like play it back later?
The video you saw, that track, we exported from the app, so it saves kind of like logs
okay.
to run, and then you can pick whichever song you want to export it with.
Okay.
Does it track the speed as well?
It doesn't do speed right now. Be a little bit more complex. Different chips to do that.
And we were also curious,
when we can purchase one and how much it costs.
So we're going to go live on Kickstarter probably the first or second week of December. And if you're an early bird, get there early, it'll be $200. And then ones after that would be $239. And that one will look more like this, like the tiny one, not the the purple.
Okay, thank you very much. Just two quick things before we close out tonight. One, I wanted to personally thank Eric Grimmelman. Eric, I'll raise your hand. Eric is responsible essentially for NITEC, and he formed the group from with a couple of other individuals. But if it weren't for Eric, none of us would be here, and none of these great events would be possible. So thank you very much, Eric. One final note, please come on January 8th. Those speakers are amazing. It will be a great night, the gamification debate night. Thank you very much. Have a good night.